You playing poker for the noobs. Gotta bring a growth mindset, positive attitude. I'm here for beginners every single weekday. Let's review the rules of poker by repeating what I say. Clockwise around the table is the direction of the play. The dealer button, two to the left, they've gotta pay. Everyone else, they should raise more chips or fold. Once somebody does, you can call to match the bet they told. Three cards come on the table with two left to come in. Gotta match your cards to make the best five card hand to win. If no one bets and you check, you don't pay, but you don't earn. Type exclamation point beginner in the chat to learn. Two more cards, two more rounds. If you see a chance, take it. At the end, you show your hand to win or fake it till you make it. I'm a noob playing poker for the noobs. Gotta bring a growth mindset, positive attitude. I'm here for beginners every single weekday. Ask me questions if you want to learn some more as I play. Good morning, boys and girls. A little late getting online because I was expecting somebody to knock on my door right at 10 a.m. and then they didn't. And then I checked my text and they were like, see you at noon. And I was like, oh, okay. So that's what's happening. Finishing off my soda and booting up my tea. This stream, as usual, is brought to you by nerdtees.ca. They will give you 15% off at checkout if you use the code QUEEN at checkout. nerdtees.ca. All right, today we're going to be talking a beginner lesson on math. Now, don't run away. I don't know if you got like math anxiety, misplaced math anxiety. I know I used to, because I had like a really mean grade 5 teacher who was just so cruel to me that for years I decided I was just bad at math and I couldn't do math and stuff like that. And it was right at grade 5, which is exactly kind of the level of math that we use in poker. So I understand if you have some math anxiety. But the good news is you can sit back on your butt and watch Twitch and improve your math skills. I'm not kidding, because I'm going to give you a little easy, simple math lesson today. And then I'm going to play games and look for those opportunities to talk about the math. All right. So I'm going to bring up all kinds of tools today. We're going to bring up a virtual playing card deck. We're gonna bring up my calculator so that I can demonstrate to you what's going on. Oh yes. So there are some really common math situations in poker that come up, and I just want to go over those real quickly before I start playing so that we can look for them together while I am playing. Okay, know what I mean, Jelly Bean? So here's what was gonna go. So a lot of the time, you are drawing to a hand. That means you've got four cards to a flush or four cards to a straight, and you need just one more card to make your flush or your straight. And you know that your opponent, you know, otherwise, they got you beat. So let's say that we have a situation where we are drawing to an awesome flush. Let's say that there's a king on the board. Let's say that our opponent, we're pretty sure he has a king because he only bets when he's got like really awesome hands. Oh yeah, he really loves that king. He's playing a king queen right here. And let's say that there are a couple, there's a club on the board here. And let's say we're playing some things as well. Let's say we're playing with a jack and a nine. No, that'll make too much close to a straight. Let's do a seven and a six. Let's say we were playing 7-6 suited preflop, and our opponent was playing king queen preflop, and we're pretty sure here that they are drawing to the better hand, right? Like at this point on the flop, they've got the better hand. We know that they've got the king. But we are drawing to something that could be even better to their hand, right? So right now we have four cards to a flush. Let's say this is a community card. So we've got the king and the queen of spades. We've got two here. So we're gonna use a little trick called the rule of four and two to determine what is the chances that we're gonna be able to complete our flush by the end of the betting rounds, the river, because there's two cards left to come out as community cards on the table, the turn and the river. And what we do is, because there's a 4% chance of us making it, we're going to multiply what we call our outs by four. What outs are is those are the cards that are still out there in the deck that we're hoping to get. We're hoping our opponent doesn't have those cards. Here we can see that he doesn't, but in real life, he might be holding one of our outs. So there are 13 spades in the deck, right? We've got to subtract what we see in front of us. That means we have 9 spades left in the deck. Those are our outs. We've got 9 outs left in the deck. So what we're going to do here is we're going to multiply those 9 outs by 4. Da, da, da. And we get 36. That's the percentage of the time, roughly, that you will hit your flush by the river in this situation. Now, it's not exact. And when I was new in poker, I really wanted to be exact. So I looked up charts of all the numbers and I made flashcards and I went on a really long 5-hour airplane flight and I memorized the exact odds for everything, in not only in percentage, but also in ratios. And then I realized that that's not really necessary. So you don't have to do that. Now, let's say another card comes out and it doesn't help any of us. Let's say it's a brick, as we call it. It's a 3. What now? Well, now we're going to cut that number in half. We're going to multiply our outs again, but we're going to multiply them by 2. So in this case, we still got 9 outs. There's still 9 spades out there in the deck, right? But we're going to multiply it by 2. And we've only got an 18% chance of completing our flush. Now, that doesn't mean a whole lot in and of itself, but we're going to compare it with our pot odds, which means what kind of bet is our opponent challenging us with, right? And pot odds are the whole amount that you could win in this gamble, including the amount that you put in, and you're going to take the amount that you're risking and divide it by that whole big pot. So let's say that on the flop here, it was a min-raised pot. That means there was 2 big blinds that we decided to raise to. Our opponent calls, so there's 4 in the pot. Let's say that our opponent bets 1 big blind at us, right? So that would mean that we've got 4 in the pot, plus 1, that's 5. If we call him, that's 6. So that would mean that we're risking 1 to win 6, our pot odds would be about 17%. That's pretty good odds, hey, because it'd be incorrect for us not to call here. Now let's say that we've got that pot and now it's got 6 in there because we called. Let's say that our opponent now bets half the pot. So he's gonna bet 3 at us. So that means we've got our pot of 6, he's put 3 in there, plus if we call, we're going to put 3 in there. That means our pot is now at 12. So we're risking 3 to win 12, which means the pot odds are 25%. Now, do you remember what percentage we had? Hi. Yeah, I know there's study today, but I'm doing the Dare to Stream competition. And also, yeah, my calendar is so incredibly full now. So I might miss it. Trying to get in 10 hours this week so that I can win a ticket to a $55 MTT that happens on Saturday. We'll see if that happens. Last week I was able to stream 10 hours, but this week has been crazy. All right. Yes, I do. I do have a delay. I have a delay because, for those of you who don't know, she knows, she's a poker player, she knows what's up. But for those of you who don't know, I play for real money, and so I do stream with a delay, because otherwise there's stream sniping, and that's no fun. That's no fun at all. Okay. So remember that we took our 9 outs, we multiplied them by 2 for the last card. That's 18%, which is less than 25%, which is a bad deal. It's a bad deal. We're going to fold. I'm going to show 2 more examples of things that come up really frequently in poker, and then we're gonna look for them out in the real world so that I can show all the new people what it's like. Okay, so now we're gonna look for a straight draw. Okay, we're gonna start talking about two different kinds of straight draws. So let's say that we've got on the board a king and a queen, and let's say that we have in our hand a jack and a 10. And let's say that our opponent, again, he's got a pair of kings here. So we know that he's got kind of the best hand at this point, right? He's gonna have a king. He's gonna maybe have, he's got king nine. Yeah, he's got that. He decided to call us in the big blind there or something like that. Okay, so let's say, you missed the nice glasses. Thanks, yeah. I do a lot of crazy filters and all that stuff. All right, so let's say that we've got a king nine and then, or king queen, and then we've got like just a brick there. And let's say that we are drawing to this straight draw. So what's our straight draw here? Actually, let's not give him a nine because that might be a little too nice for him. Let's give him a really good hand. Let's say he has a pair of kings. And we know that he's going to beat us with three of a kind kings unless we make our straight. Well, let's take a look then. Our straight is king, queen, jack, 10. That's called a double ender straight because you can hit a card on either end of it, right? We could get either an ace or we could get, so ace, king, queen, jack, 10, or we could get king, queen, jack, 10, 9. So an ace or a 9. So there's four aces in the deck and there's four nines in the deck. That gives us 8 outs. Now we can use that same rule of 4 and 2. We can take those 8 outs. We're going to multiply it by 4. That's 32%. Pretty sweet, right? Remember when he was betting into us and he was offering us like 17% odds? It would be incorrect for us not to call for that. Now remember though, if the turn doesn't really help us a whole heck of a lot, then we're going to need to have that number because we're multiplying those 8 outs by 2. What are you doing? You're a good boy. It's my rescue dog. I keep having to make sure he's not playing with like something he shouldn't, you know, like a sock or a toy that's my kid's toy, but he's playing with his toy. He's being a good boy. So yeah, if he's offering us 17% or something like that, it's right borderline. And then on the turn, if he's going to offer us like 25% odds, we've got to fold. Let me show you another kind of straight. This is the last kind of thing that I want to show because it's the last really common straight situation. So let's say instead of the 10, we were playing with a jack 9. And let's say we don't have a flush draw on this turn. We're not looking at the turn yet. So now we've got a different kind of straight draw. King, queen, blank, or queen, queen, jack, blank, 9. So my kingdom for a 10, right? Well now, how many outs do we have in the deck? There's 4 tens in the deck. Well, now you can see our odds are not as good. 4 times 4 is 16. So if we face a 17% pot bet here, you know, over pot odds, then we're gonna want to consider folding unless we know our opponent. And it's kind of borderline. We're gonna call a lot of flops anyway. But let's say if we end up on the turn with nothing that helps us, we're gonna take that 16%. We're gonna divide it in half. That's only 8%. People are really rarely offering you 8% pot odds on the turn. So we're going to have to fold in those situations. Okay, those were some examples. Now I'm going to boot up a poker game. I'm going to play a cash game today. And we're going to look for those situations coming up, those mathy situations. And we're also going to talk about the things that we talked about earlier this week. Let me rearrange my stuff. Hey girl, it's good to see you. Hi. Thanks for stopping by. Yeah, Queen Black Cat. Awesome. She's got a fantastic stream too. Let's shout you out. Queen Black Cat. Yo, yo, yo. Thank you. Appreciate it. Hey. Fantastic. All right. We're going to be looking at some examples of math today because I'm helping some beginners figure out some of that awesome, awesome math. And so I'm rearranging stuff so that I can get a table up here. And it'll be good. It'll be good. It'll be good. We're going to play a cash game today because I'm feeling the cash game practice today. Yes, I am. Cash games, for those of you who are new to poker, are where you just plop down your buy-in at the table. You play with that. And then when you're ready to leave, you just scoop up your chips and you go. So that's pretty cool. All right. I'm going to boot up. My bot bit you. Thank you, baby. You're awesome. All right, we're going to play some cash game. Let me pop open the game. And right now we're waiting for the big blind to roll around. Let me see if my mouse highlighter is going to work today. It's been so janky lately. Okay, it's working for now. Let's see how long it works. Usually when I click, this thing gets mad. So for those of you new to poker, these are the blind bets. People had to put those in before they even saw their cards. And that's just to start the negotiations of the poker hand. So this person is the dealer button. If you were playing poker at my kitchen table with my mom friends, you would be literally dealing. But online, it's just signified by the dealer button. All right, queen, take it easy. See you soon. I will have a good stream. I was sweating it today because PokerStars like locked my account for a little bit and I was like, oh my god, no! Not right before my stream! But then they unlocked my account. Support is great. Support is great on Twitter. For PokerStars. Okay, so this person is betting here. See, there's two different flush draw potentials on the board. Once you start looking at the math, you'll start looking at other people's draws as well, and that's where it gets really special because you can spoil their pot odds, right? So here I am in the big blind, and the small blind is going to raise me. I'm going to re-raise them. Do, do, do. Boop. And they folded, giving up their interest in the hand so that I could collect their chips. Now I'm paying the small blind. You notice we all take turns doing it, so it's all fair. I'm going to raise, challenging my opponent to call, re-raise, or fold. They decided to make the fold. Cool, cool. I'm going to fold this one too, even though I'm on the dealer button, which is the lucky seat, as we talked about yesterday. Yay, my mouse highlighter so far is working. Hurrah. Going to fold this though. This is actually like the first time I've played cash games on PokerStars in a long time. So we'll see how this game quality is. Are these guys going to be tough or are they going to be easy? We'll see. So now I'm in what's called middle position because I've got some people left to act behind me. I'm still going to raise though. This person has less than 100 big blinds, so I'm going to imagine that they're a fish for now because that's kind of a fish alert thing. A fish alert, a fish alert, a fish alert. A terrible death that I, a terrible death that I, a terrible death, a terrible death, a terrible death that I. It's a fish alert, a fish alert, a fish alert. Woohoo! Okay, so now we have a paired board. This one is really cool because we can bet a lot of the time. And we will be able to get fish to fold. Since I believe this guy is a fish, I'm betting 90% of the pot because this is something that Coach Brad Wilson of Chasing Poker Greatness recommends for playing against fish on what we call this paired dynamic board. Our friend is going to give it a think. He's like, I don't believe you, but that's a really big bet, my friend. We can always give up on the turn if he calls. He's gonna give it a think. We have some nice weight music going on. Oh, he's gonna raise me. Nice one, my broski. He gets to take it down. Hey, why didn't my thing top up? Hold on, something's wrong in my Poker Stars setting. I'm going to sit out next big blind if I can't fix it. Because I want to be able to top up my account every hand. Do, 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 do. So we're going to get in the settings. We're going to get in those settings. We want auto rebuy. Automatically. Hey, here we go. We get to play this one, which is nice. Is it under gameplay? And I don't love this flop. I do not love it. We are out of position. This is a pretty dynamic flop, and so I'm going to make a check here. Check. Auto rebuy. Okay, there we go. Auto rebuy cash. If automatically rebuy, if I fall under, oops. Yeah, he's gonna bet, we're gonna let it go. Why is it, not letting me? 100, there we go. Do, 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 do. Normally I would play that, but I'm trying to apply some changes so that it'll automatically top me up. Let's see if this works. Let's try it again. Auto rebuy. If I fall under 100 big blinds. Do, 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 do. It's still not working. Automatically add chips to table. No, not table minimum. There we go. Let's say 100 big blinds. Okay. Hopefully this works. Yay! It's working! Hooray! Okay, sorry about that. Needed to tweak some settings. Sometimes when you get set up playing a game on a new site, things are all a little janky at first. But thankfully, PokerStars has like a lot of customizable settings, which I really enjoy. Let's check and see where's my rescue dog go. Where he go? Where's my Nipper? Nipper, where you at? Nipper. We'll have to check on him once I have a little quick break ski to get some more beverage. Okay, here it is. Let me take a quick break to get things all settled and then I'll be way more focused. I'm back. I've cleared everything up. Keeping my rescue dog out of trouble, hopefully. Trying to keep him in eyesight. Nimmer! Come on! Nimmer! You gotta stay up here. Where I can keep an eye on you, because you're naughty. Because you're naughty! Eesh. Getting a rescue dog is a little bit of a challenge. Has anybody ever done that? I mean, I've done it before. But, you know, it's kind of like having a baby. Well, kind of like having a toddler. You know, you always got to keep your eye on them. Make sure they're not doing the crazy stuff.
Yes.
Good boy. You're being good. Good nipper. Good down. Okay. Now he's laying down. We can get back to our game. I'm back. And now we're going to watch this game play out. So here's another one of those paired boards. Now, if somebody was drawing to a straight draw, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, it's very unlikely that they have a 7-4, right? So when you're trying to see whether your opponent is drawing to a straight, one thing you have to ask is it a believable straight? Now, it's more likely that they have something like an 8-9 for a straight draw. And now we've got an 8 here. That does complete a straight if they had like a 9-10. That would have been a gut shot type straight, right? That's that one where you're plugging in the center of the straight. I'm going to have some, my own little poker hand rankings chart put into my about section soon because I'm getting one commissioned by our own Queen Black Cat, but I don't have it yet. So you're going to have to Google a hand rankings chart if you're still learning about that, or you can type exclamation point beginner in chat and my bot will talk to you about it. All right, we are in the big blind. We have King 10, which is definitely a hand that could potentially make a straight. We're going to look today for these situations where we can use our math to help us make decisions. And I'm going to show you with this calculator. Even though I don't need the calculator, it could be really good for illustrating some of these points. Okay, we're going to multiply it by 3 and raise it. We get a fold. That's nice, isn't it? Fold this guy too. Just not good enough, even though theoretically it can make a straight. It's pretty low, and it doesn't have the same suit. Hey, we got a pair of tens. So right now we're sitting in a position at the table called the cutoff, and the position called under the gun raised. An interesting amount. So we're going to re-raise them to about 7.5, let's say. And now they can call, re-raise again, or fold. If they re-raise again, that's called a 4-bet. And we're just going to call if it's a reasonable size. They chose not to. Somebody else trying to sell me followers. Why? Why would I buy followers? That's not how Twitch works. No thanks. They are on Twitch, though, going to introduce Twitch Boost, which helps introduce you, I guess, to other viewers. So anyway, we're out of position against this person, and this is a pretty dry board. We're going to go ahead and follow up with this size bet. When they call, we're going to go ahead and follow up with a, let's see, the pot is about 10, and then we're going to go raise it really big because this is called a chain bet, and this is what Brad Wilson, again, recommended against fishy players. We also have a draw here now. The ace, deuce, 3-4 is a draw, a straight draw. It's the only situation where ace is low in Texas Hold'em. So if you've been wondering out there whether ace is low or high, in Texas Hold'em, ace is always high except for in this specific scenario. Then we're going to fold that. That's a nope, my dog. Okie doke. Now we're in the big blind again. Hey, we get another do-over with the tens. Now the position, the earliest position at our table raised under the gun. This time we're just going to call in the big blind. And since we're out of position, we don't have the aggression stick. We weren't the one raising. We're going to check to our opponent and call with our second pair. Now let's take a look. We have 7, 8, blank, 10, jack, queen. We don't really have a straight draw. I know it can be confusing when you're a beginner, but you don't want to be chasing something that's never going to really make a straight. Oh, it's always embarrassing when you're new to poker and you show down a hand and you think you have a straight, but you really don't. Yeah, but it's still a good idea if you ever go to a casino as a beginner to always show your hand at the end, whether or not you think you won, because if you're new to poker, you might think you lost, but you actually did win. In fact, speaking of poker stars, my son once had that happen around a family poker game where he was throwing away his hand thinking that he lost. Turned out he had made a flush and he had won. And he said, "Mom, take a picture of me and put a label on it that says poker star." Yes. He's adorable. Oh, he's adorable. But yeah, it's really easy for flushes to be confusing for beginners and straights. Okay, so let's see what's happening here. Is there some draws? Absolutely. There are straight draws all up and down this board, and there are two different kinds of flush draws. Now remember, if he has a flush draw, then it means he's only got that 18% chance on the turn, right? Because we've got 36% on the flop, but we have to cut that in half on the turn. Oh yes, we do. I'm going to show you some math to illustrate some concepts throughout this stream. So if you've got math anxiety and you need to get past it, just sit back, relax, grab yourself a snack. I'll talk through some math situations when they do come up. If they do come up, you know, we do have to hope they look out. So this person might have gotten their flush, potentially. Whenever you see three of the same suit on the board, it means that a flush is technically possible. It's out there, potentially. All right, we've got King 10, but we are in the earliest position here. We're gonna fold it. You'll notice that I did play that King 10 when I was over in the button, I believe. And that is something that we play when we're in later position, but not when we're in earlier position. So this person raised and this person re-raised and everybody folded to the re-raise. All right, here we are in the big blind again and that person's re-raising, ooh, yet again. We're gonna fold, we're gonna color this person with an orange shirt just because they've been doing that a little bit. And we want to keep an eye on them and see what they're doing that with. All right. So today I'm playing 50 NL. That means 25 cent, 50 cent games. And the buy-in that I used was $50. But if you are new to poker, you don't have to play this high. The buy-in that you can pay if you want to try cash games, if you pay $2, you can buy into a one penny, two penny game. Now, the bankroll that you should have for it, if you were a winning player, would be $200 because you'd want 100 buy-ins or so, or at least 50. But if you're new and you know you're not going to be winning the games, you don't have to have a bankroll. What you have to have is a budget. And my budget when I was first starting out was, for some reason, $13 a month. And that was enough. That was enough for me to get into it and have enough fun and do some learning. Okay, so now we're in the cutoff with our suited connectors. Suited connectors means cards that are next to each other in rank, like 5-6. And the same suit. We got 3-bet by the button. This is about a little too low for me to call with. I might have called with something a little higher, like a 6-7, but not the 6-5. Goodbye, 6-5. And this one's offsuit. They're not the same suit, so they're not as valuable. We're gonna fold them in that situation. Gonna go ahead and label this guy. And we have a jack and a 5 suited here. And we're in the big blind. In the big blind, we call with a lot of suited hands. Oh, we gotta walk though. When everybody folds and I'm in the big blind, that means I get to keep the blinds. Yay me. Now this one is suited connectors, yes, but it's so low that it's not worth playing from the small blind. The small blind is the worst place to play from because you have to act first for the rest of the hand, and that's a huge bummer. It's a major, major disadvantage in poker. So we don't like to do that. In the small blind, we prefer to either raise or fold. Hey, we got aces. We love to sit. Let's see if anybody wants to play me with them. Yes, this person does. Okay, so we have top pair. This person called. We are in position. And this board, we would say, is, I mean, fairly dynamic. We're going to give it a continuation bet. Because we were the pre-flop aggressor, so we can keep swinging around that aggression baton. He's going to raise us. I'm going to just flat call, because I'm not too afraid of the spade draw since I have a spade. Maybe I should have been afraid of the straight draw, though. Do, 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 do. We're going to call this one because he gave us pretty decent odds. Ugh, so straighty. My aces do not look so great anymore. Not so great. I'm going to check this. My friendo, he was indeed drawing to that straight. Okay, we're going to raise here. La da 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 da. We've got ace king. Even though it's offsuit, ace king is a very strong hand. It can make what we call the nut straight, which is the highest straight available. We have another one of these paired boards. It's so we're going to hit it with another bet. This time I'm going to hit it with a 30% bet. About 33% rather. Now, technically, we do have this like ace deuce tray, but remember, we don't consider those necessarily draws. We will call this bet though, this raise. And then we're going to check. Now look at what pot odds he offers us. Now, he is betting 7.56, so the pot is 22.7. So, we're risking about 8 to win about 30. And so that's not going to be worth it at all. We don't have a proper straight draw here. We're going to fold it. You always got to think risk versus reward. It's like in real life. That's what poker prepares you for. I'm always telling my kids, risk versus reward. You know, figure it out. The other day, I can't remember what it was. I think my son wanted to do something dangerous, slightly dangerous, you know. And I said something like, well, where is your head going to go if you fall? Risk versus reward, right? And he said, you could have just said no. And I'm like, well, I want you to think for yourself. I want my voice to be in your head saying risk versus reward, you know, is the momentary joy of doing this worth the potential downside? Now, normally this is a hand that I would play from this position, but we had this person in very early position raising. Even though they like to raise a lot of stuff, it's just not worth it. If they're raising an ace, they're raising a better one. This person decided to re-raise or increase the size of the bet. And he got a fold with that. This guy likes to re-raise as well. Now we're in the cutoff. We don't have a good enough hand to play. We're going to say goodbye-bye. Hey, ace-queen is nice. We're going to raise to put pressure on the blind bets that are already in the pot to fold. This person matched on the button. They just called in order to see a flop. Here comes the flop. And what we are is we're actually out of position to them. That means we have to act first. This is about a semi-dry board. I'm going to bet about half pot. And we get to see a fold from our fishy fish. Yay, fishy fish. And here we go. We love the fishy guy. He's letting himself get very low. That's a good sign because it's a fish alert, a fish alert, a fish alert. A terrible death that I, a terrible death that I, a terrible death, a terrible death, a terrible death that I. It's a fish alert, a fish alert, a fish alert. Woo! Hey, we got aces again. We are running hot for our starting hands today. Let's see if anybody wants to play with it, though. Oh, that guy didn't. Yay, our fish is in here with it. Now we are in position. They acted first. They just checked to us. This is what we call a semi-dry board. We have some value. We're going to bet a third. And they folded. Womp, 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 womp. That's okay. We still got chips. We still won. Okie dokie. So now let's look for some other draws that our opponents might have while they're playing this hand. Straight draws, flush draws, a straight, a flush. All right, let's bust out our calculator. Do we have any draws on this board? And I'll show you some pot odds too. How about, maybe not this hand, maybe this hand. Even this song, though this song isn't really jazz, I like it. It's very peaceful, so I like it when it comes on this jazz station. This is Twitch soundtrack, by the way, so it's safe for use on Twitch. They've caused us such drama with the music. I like to put on some jazz because it gives like a classy poker card room feel to me, you know? Not like a casino with like the blaring ding 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 of the slot machines. That environment can be fun, but it can also be a little like overwhelming, you know, sensory overload. And most poker players I find are playing the electronic music, which is great, you know, but this is your place for chill jazz. Okay, we are in the big blind here. Let's see who is going to play against us. Nobody. We get a walk. Fantastic. And this guy raised. Let's see if we can illustrate some concepts this hand. Let's do it. Okay, so this is a flop that we call pretty dynamic. There's a straight now that's totally possible. Queen, Jack, 10, right? So if somebody had a 9-8 or they had an ace king, they would have the straight. And now it's 4 to a straight because the 8 is here. So anyone with a 9 is feeling pretty happy about it. And this person's making the bet. Do you believe them? Do you believe that they have the straight? Let's see if Vrinny does. Vrinny's giving it a think. So today I'm going to be hosting another tournament for Poker Power, which is an organization I work for that's dedicated to teaching 1 million women how to play poker and turn the tables on the felt and in life. If you're a female out there and you want to learn to play poker, hey, I'm here for you. Ask questions. But there's also a series of 12 lessons that you can take for free. It takes an hour out of your week for 12 weeks. And you can go to pokerpower.com and sign up for them in like 4 lesson batches at a time. So you don't have to feel overwhelmed. Just start out with 4 and try it out. You'll really love it. Okay, so we've got a check from Vrinny here, which as well he should because he's not in position. He doesn't have the aggression baton. Now our friend does put a continuation bet in because he could definitely have the ace as the in position raiser. He called or matched to proceed in the hand. Straight draw potential here, right? 5-6. So if he had a 7-9, he would have the straight. He's not acting like he does though. So our friend can bluff here potentially. He chooses not to. Oh, he had the ace the whole time. What a sneaky sneaker. What a sneaky sneaker. Yeah. Sleeper lying in wait. Lying in wait. Ba 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 da da ba da ba ba. Shabba doo dap dap da. Shabba doo dow. Shabba doo dow. We're gonna give him. I mean, we don't want to say that he's like real great at poker. We're gonna give him that because I'm gonna say that he's a little passive with how he played that hand. Okay. Let's see what goes down here. Now he raised to put pressure on the blinds to fold and also to disguise the strength of his hand. It's gonna work on me with this hand. It's not good enough to call with. Ba 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 da 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 da. I don't want to raise this guy either. Okay, let's keep looking on our straights and flushes today and see if we can show you some math concepts. See if I can show you some pot odds. Those are always good to display. Okay, let's see what we got. Nope, nothing this time. Boop. Ooh, we have an early position raise. What does that mean? It means that they usually have a stronger range of hands that they play from early position because they're first to act, huge downside. You gotta bring something that can take the heat if you're going in the kitchen there. He continued betting, saying he had something. This is a very straight each board. They both check the turn. He checks the river. They both had king queen. Oh, that's adorable. Super adorbs. So he called that, right? With basically nothing, we're going to give him a label. He's also fairly low on chips. Our friend took off there. Okay, we are in the big blind again. Let's see if we're playing. Oh, yay, we got a walk. That works too. And a 7-8, it's not suited though, not valuable enough. This person made a very small raise from early position. It's smaller, indicating he's not sure what he's doing here. Not quite sure. We can add like a weird little thing of flair. We can brag that we've played over 100,000 real money hands of poker. I don't know if I want to brag that, though. I think I want to pretend like I don't know what I'm doing and put the twos there. Be like, the way I don't know what I'm doing, I got deuces. Deuces! I think that all of us who wear the deuces on our sleeve, though, are actually people who have played more hands. We're just pretending that we haven't. Bash GR! This is our new friend at the table. We don't know how he plays yet, so we're just gonna watch him and see. We're gonna watch and see, my guys. So here we have a straight draw and a flush draw. In fact, there could even be a straight flush draw. He's gonna go ahead and bet. This guy called or just matched to stay in the hand. And the flush completes on the river. Somebody who had two spades in their hand would be very happy now. This guy checks. He doesn't put any more chips in. He can either check or bet. He chooses to make a bet. And got a fold from our friendo there. Hey, we've got a king and a jack, and they are the same suit. That's a fairly valuable hand. Let's see what we're doing. So he just decided to limp to us. We're going to raise him. This is called an isolation raise, something we do a lot in those spin and go games. We don't have to do it a lot here usually. Okay, we're gonna go ahead and bet because this is technically like a three bet pot. Another nine comes. We don't have anything at this point, so we don't want to shovel more chips in the pot. And we have a queen on the river. We're gonna check it down with our king high. Sometimes a king high will win. Sometimes an ace high will win. Anything less than that, you're probably gonna have to bluff your face off. Our friend, though, I have colored pink because he loves to call the flop with darn near anything, including two random overcards. And that's why he lost that one. Hey, we've got a paired board. This one's great for the pre-flop aggressor to bet and say, yes, I have a thing. Yes, I have a thing. Because it's less likely that somebody has anything, right? Unless they have a six or a nine or like a straight draw or that flush draw. So it's kind of a paired dynamic board. Eve, spades, it's what's for dinner. Ay, ay, ay. Yeah, y'all. Okay. We got this. We got nothing. Let's watch our friends and keep looking for those straight and flush draws. He's sitting out. He's not gonna act in time. So we have a raise from middle position. And it got everybody to fold. People know what it means when you get raises from early to middle position. People know. It's tough stuff. Now I'm going to be the one raising from what's middle position here. And they believed me too. Even little old me and my lying black heart. Okay. Now what we like to see for strategy, a good strategy is always to raise if you're the first one in. That's kind of a small raise. 2.5 or 3 is better. I'm going to fold because it's just such a garbage hand. And here comes the flop. There's a flush draw with the two spades, if somebody had two spades in their hand. And there's a straight draw with Jack 10. A few straight draws here, right? So somebody could have 9-8, somebody could have 8-7, somebody could have king-queen. All kinds of situations that can arise with two connected cards on the board that cause people to want to be interested in that game. Yes, it can be hard to bluff people off of a hand. Okay, now there is a diamond flush draw. And there is a straight draw with the queen and the nine that didn't get there. None of the draws got there. So this is a place where people will bluff. It's often a good place to call with a bluff catcher, too, because you know people are bluffing when they didn't hit their straight or their flush. And this is another connected hand, but they're not suited. Ooh, this guy limped. It's a fish alert, a fish alert, a fish alert. A terrible death that I, a terrible death that I. Terrible death, a terrible death, a terrible death that I. It's a fish alert, a fish alert, a fish alert. Woo! And then they're both like, get me out of this hand. Check, check, check. Oh, now this guy's going to come out betting because he has more aggression. He's going to raise, though. He's like, oh, yeah. Now, what did he limp with? I'm guessing it's like a pocket pair. Might be a good one, though, and he thinks he's going to beat this straight. I don't know. Now there's a flush complete, too. And that guy's all in. This would be a really tough board to bluff. Yeah, he did have three of a kind tens, but they were worthless on that super straighty board. This guy is very, very much not as skilled a player. So he ran away, which is too bad. Too bad. We want another fish to come in here. Another fish, please. Now we've got a king and an eight, and they're both the same suit. However, we have a raise from the button. And so we're going to fold. Hope to have some more fishies join this game. All right, now we're going to raise from the button. Remember, the dealer button is the best place to play from because you're going to be acting last for the rest of the hand after this. This guy decides to raise from the small blind. That's called a three bet. And it's going to get a fold from me for this particular hand. Notice the people who are most aggressive are the people who are racking up the chips. because aggressive poker is winning poker. Now, what aggression means in poker is betting and raising instead of checking and calling. And I know that's a little counterintuitive and weird. Like, how is throwing your money at someone aggressive? But in poker, that's what we call it. There's a lot of interesting terminology in poker. I'm not going to call with that. You can't make a straight with it, so it's far less valuable than it might appear initially. This guy's like an angry My Little Pony. I love it. There's like less and less people here. Hopefully we get another person here and the sitting out person either comes back or whatevs. But luckily that guy was kind of relentlessly three betting me, so that's okay. Okay, we're in the big blind with a pair of fours. We're facing a very small raise size. We can give a call. And then we're going to check because we are out of position. We act first. We want to see what our opponent does. We can call one with our pair. Now we have a flush draw. This is where we can show you some math if he bets here, because the fours are no good at this point, right? I mean, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, maybe with the straight draw. So the five is four outs. Didn't get there. And the flush would be nine outs. So if he had bet us, that would be 9 plus 4 multiplied by 4 for on the flop and then 2 on the turn. Okay, we're going to go ahead and raise this one. And whew, look at how straighty this is. This is called a code red board. We're gonna just check it because there could definitely already be a straight out there and we don't want to mess with that. No, sir. No, 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 no. I'm gonna sit out next big blind so I can get myself another cup of tea. Welcome if you just joined me. I'm glad to see you. I'm teaching beginner poker math. Beginner poker math lesson. If you missed the beginning of it where I talked through the math initially, it's on my VOD. And here I'm looking for examples that I can show you. So a king and a jack, we like to raise that. It's got high cards. It can make high pairs. It also can make a straight. Yay! Wouldn't that be nice, my friends? So I am out of position to this guy because he gets to act first. I am actually in middle position. And we got raised or three bet by the big blind. So we're going to fold this. It is offsuit. I might have called if it had the same suit. It would have boosted my percentage chance of winning just a little bit more. And that's worth it. I like how these chips look. They're nice and clear. It's like 25 cents. It's just a bunch of quarters. Here comes the flop. And there's a straight draw with the 7 and 8 connected. There's also a flush draw with the two spades if somebody has two spades in their hand. Now he makes a big bet. It's 9.4 big blinds into 37. So, you know, that means you're risking about 10 to win about 50, you know? Little interesting pot odds there. We're going to fold this one. It's just not quite in the range of what I would play from that position. Booyah! All right, we have a raise and a call. Somebody just matched that raise in order to see a flop. Let's see if the blinds are going to 3-bet or re-raise. They do not. So the 6 and the 5 offer a straight draw. But other than that, not a lot going on. If you had a king in your hand, you'd be fairly certain that you have the best hand for now. So this guy makes a bet. This guy can call, raise, or fold. Oh, now it's very more straighty. 4, 5, 6. So if somebody had a 7, 8, they'd be pretty happy. Unlikely somebody has 2, 3, right? So now let's see what they do. If you had a king, you might want to slow down the shoveling of chips into the pot. Because there's a potential you could be drawing dead. All right, here we go. There's this guy making a nice big bet. This guy raises him, representing something awesome or trying to protect desperately a king. see what happens. Is our friend going to call, raise again, or fold? If he raises again, he should probably raise all in because his stack is less than the pot is. That's called SPR, or stack to pot ratio. And when that's one, you gotta just go all in. That's the only move you got left. He's gotta give it a real long think. I feel like this guy has a king and he's thinking, wait a minute on this straight. Wait a minute. He's giving it a big long think and he made the fold. Okay, I'm sitting out for now, so I'm going to take a quick break so I can pour myself another cup of tea. I'll see you in just a moment. Hello, I'm back with my cup of tea. Remember, as usual, this stream is sponsored by nerdtees.ca. Use code QUEEN at checkout to get 15% off. Let's get back into this cash game that we're playing and talk some more about the math of poker, the math of odds and outs. Let's see what's going on here. We're looking for straight draws and flush draws. That means four cards to a straight, or four cards to a flush, where you just need one more to make the best five card hand. Now, a flush, for those of you who are new to poker, is all five cards of the same suit. It doesn't necessarily mean that they need to be in order of any kind, right? So, like, these two are hearts. If somebody had two hearts in their secret hole cards, then that would mean they had a flush draw. They'd have four to a flush. A straight draw is when you have cards that are all in the row according to rank. So like deuce, tray, four, five, six, something like that. Or ace, king, queen, jack, 10. And so here we go. Let's take a look for those straight draws and flush draws and calculate our odds of hitting them and our opponent's odds of hitting them before we make our bets. I'm on vacation every single day because I love my occupation. I'm on vacation every single day. All right, we're almost there. We're waiting for the big blind to roll around. These two are the blind bets. Those are the ones put in before anyone even sees their cards to start the negotiations of the poker hand. Welcome if you've just joined me. I'm here to motivate and inspire gamers on Twitch to try poker, the game of math, money, and mindset. And today we're talking about the math. We are, but don't be afraid. You can sit back with some snacks and learn a little math. Practice your mental math skills. So this is the pot size. This is the amount of moolah in the pot. Watch what happens when we see a call, if we do. Boom, the pot increased in size. So now that was the call amount added to the pot. Keep an eye on that pot if we see another bet. Now there's four to a flush. That means if anyone has even one heart card in their hand, they have a flush. This person had the Ten of Hearts, so they got it. Do, 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 do. This person raised from early position. That means they acted first, which means they have to have a really good hand to act first, because there's so many people to act behind them with hands that could potentially beat them. So here's the pot size. There's the bet size that's challenging everyone. It's already been added to this pot here. I have my pot displayed in, everything displayed in units of the big blind, because that's what matters in poker a lot of the time, is how much you have in relation to how big the big blind is. It's especially important in tournaments when the blinds increase in price. It's very much like inflation in the economy and the purchasing power of your chips goes down. So here's the pot size. Let's show you what pot odds are, if we can see an example. We'll see if this guy bets or not. So, let's see. I would love to show some examples, but these people are pretty slow with their samples. Da na 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 ba da 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 da. So this is the turn card. All right, this person made a pretty hefty sized bet into the pot. So there was 856. Now there's 1386. And then So in that particular pot, 13.86 plus it was like about 9. The whole pot would have been about 23. So you were risking about 9 to win 23. So the pot odds would have been about 40% for that particular transaction. Now the pot is at 7-ish. And nobody bets. Nobody's challenging anyone here. Nobody's getting a challenge. Need to see some challenges. People are probably afraid that the flop already has 3 clubs. So this person challenged the other one with a bet. They had to call if they had a club because it was about what? So 12, they bet about 3 into 12. So that's about 25%. And if we have 9 outs, and we multiply it by 4, that means that his equity would be 36%. So if the equity is bigger than the pot odds, in this case, the 25% is smaller than 36%. So that means we're getting a good deal. So he was right to call if he had a club in his hand. Why is everybody calling me, man? I'm not picking up that no caller ID craziness. No, sir. No caller ID means no bueno. It means it's probably a scam call. Get a lot of those in Canada, unfortunately, in Chinese, because scammers are preying on people who don't understand the Canadian legal system, who may have moved here and don't speak the language, which is awful. It's awful. Bad scammers, go away. Oh, Canadian government is not going to send a paddy wagon to your house to lock you up for random reasons. Maybe that's how they do things in other parts of the world, but not here. Okay, we have this paired board here. This is a really great community card situation on the flop for somebody who is the pre-flop aggressor. They could have bet and represented an ace or a king. They chose not to, though. They chose not to. They're just checking. They're like, get this hand over with. Now he's going to come out with a huge bet, which doesn't make much sense there. Doesn't make much sense. Oh, no, 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 no. So these folks are doing what I'm doing, which is topping back up to 100 big blinds anytime that they drop below it. And that's because you play with different strategies depending on how much you have to play with. You can imagine that your chip stack that you're playing with is kind of like your health bar, your life bar. And when you get rid of it, you're dead. So the more that you can heal yourself and top up your health bar, the less likely you are to be sad when you encounter a boss. All right, so now we're going to raise our pair of nines. Pairs are one of the kinds of hands that poker players love to play. Woo-hoo. Now we have an ace-seven, not good enough to play from right here. Now this person decided to raise, put pressure on the random blinds. So here, ace-king-10 can make a straight. There was two flush draws that didn't make it. And anytime there's a pair on the board, a full house or even four of a kind is technically possible, though less likely. So this person had the full house there and they did not bet. They were being very careful with it. They didn't bet. They should have to try and get some value from an opponent. But maybe they thought their opponent would win. I don't think so. I think they thought their opponent would bet. And you shouldn't just hope for your opponent to bet if you have value, unless you know your opponent and you know they're very, very likely to bet. Mm-hmm. But by default, if you have value, you want to build the pot. Big hand, big pot. Big hand, big pot. Always remember that one. So here we have a straight draw style board. This person's putting in pretty big bets. This person called. And now the board is looking even more straighty. And there's a flush draw added. So if you had an eight in your hand, you wouldn't be feeling very comfortable here if you just had a pair. This person's continuing to bet. This time, if this person calls, it's going to be about 90. The pot's going to be about 90. So, oops, did I close my calculator? Let's look at the pot odds that he's being given. So, like, basically, he's risking, like, 16 chips to win about 90 chips. So, the pot odds there were about 18%. Not terrible pot odds if he had a draw to a straight that was double ender potentially, because then that would be about exactly the amount that he would make his straight by the end of his odds of getting his straight. Yes. All right. So this guy's gonna raise from early position. What does that mean? It means he thinks he has a hand that's strong enough to beat everyone else who hasn't yet folded. So that's usually a sign of strength. I did color him green though, so he is a slightly fishy player. He might not know exactly what he's doing. Everybody believed him that time though. Everybody was like, yeah, let's believe him. Let's agree. Welcome, welcome. If you just joined me, I'm here to motivate and inspire gamers on Twitch to try poker, the game of math, money, and mindset. And today is a little bit of a math lesson. We're looking for situations where we can calculate pot odds, where we can calculate our equity in the hand, meaning the percent of the time that we're going to make a straight or make a flush. I like to think of equity instead of like as the percentage of the time we should win the hand. I like to think of it more as my share of the pot. So when I win the whole pot, I'm winning more than my fair share. But when I lose the pot, I'm losing more than my fair share. And it all evens out if you play a whole bunch of hands. Because poker is a long-term game. That means that you can imagine that you're playing the same hand 10,000 times in a row and ask yourself, what's the best play most of the time? All right, we're gonna raise here because we've got the best possible starting hand. We're raising bigger because we're out of position. That's what we would normally do. And hey, we've got three of a kind aces on this flop. There's also a potential for a straight draw, so I'm gonna bet here. Our opponent is likely gonna fold though. Nope, he's not going to. He's gonna come along for it. Now we've got a straight draw going on, a couple of straight draws. We're gonna bet bigger here, just in case he's calling along with one of those draws. We're giving him kind of terrible odds on purpose. Don't want to give him good odds to outdraw us. Ooh, now we have a full house. Aces full of fives. And our stack to pot ratio is about one. So we're going to just put it in. Woot! Yeah! Nice! I was wondering if he had like a three of a kind tens or something at that point. Lucky us. It was lucky, lucky us. Shoo-ba-doo-doo. Because sometimes it's lucky to get these good hands, but you also need the luck of your opponent getting a hand that they're going to call along with and go broke with. Like that. Like that one. There was a lot he was going to call me with. There was a flush that had completed on that board. And a lot of smaller full house situations. All right, let's keep going. Let's do it. We've been streaming in about an hour. It is almost 11:30 a.m. where I am in beautiful Vancouver, British Columbia, Canada. Let me know what time it is where you are. What's up? How's it going? Well, let's do some learning and some math times. So here, there's an ace and a king that make a straight draw. The king and the nine makes a straight draw. Both of those are helped by the 10. And now there's two flush draws on the board. This would be a pretty tough community card board to bluff. So I believe he has something when he's betting out here. And there you go. We've completed one of our flushes. We've completed a straight draw. Couple straight draws have completed. So if he had just a pair here, you'd be feeling a little nervous, maybe not wanting to shovel a ton of chips in the pot because only better will call and worse will fold. Our friend over here left. He left when I took away his stack. Mwah. It's all right. It's all right. We're in here practicing our cash games. I'm happy with it. And what I want to have is, these ones. We want to have hands as our default. Let me change a setting. I want to change a setting. I want to change a setting, the chat. We want the default tab to be hands. We already have default to be hands, don't we? Click to see hand history. All right. It says it's already there, but it is not fine. Okay, we've got a 7 and a 6. They're both suited. This is what we call those suited connectors, which is a type of hand that poker players like to play because it can make straights and flushes. So we're gonna raise to put pressure on the blinds to fold. We've already got two callers though. People interested in playing this hand. So calling is just matching the price of my bet to see a flop. So my 7 plus the one on the board makes a pair of 7s. There's two people in this hand, so I think this hand just wants to check and then call a bet rather than place a bet on here. Now that nobody has bet though, we're going to make a very small bet out. And if nobody has anything, they're going to want to fold. Ooh, he's going to want to raise, so we're going to get out of here. Minimal amount of chips put in. La-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. This is the worst hand in hold'em. 7, deuce offsuit. Worst hand in hold'em, my guys. All right, I'm going to pop open a soda pop because I finished that cup of tea. Yayo. Ba da 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 da. So here we go. The 6 and the 8 here make a straight draw. They also make a flush draw. If somebody had like a 7-9 in their hand, or maybe a 9-10 in their hand. Now that flush completed, I don't think either of them has it necessarily, because they're not showing a lot of interest here. Either one of them could have bet on that flop, because this person was in position and this person was a pre-flop raiser. So kind of two different reasons to potentially bet a flop. Now he's going to bet on the river. Say, I got something. It's 12. He's got to risk 12 to potentially win 33. And he decides to fold. Da 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 da. You always want to think about your risk versus reward. In life and in poker, right? Another thing that I was talking to my kids about, my daughter was like swinging on swings at the playground, and then she was having fun just basically like yeeting herself off the swing set, yeet, and like flying a long distance and crashing into the wood chips. I watched her do this for a while, and then I watched her get better and better at it until she was actually flying pretty high and pretty far. And I said, sweetheart, I love that you've made this sort of competitive sport for yourself, but if you're gonna be doing this, you need to wear a helmet. You know, like you see people doing sports like this, they wear a helmet and like knee pads and stuff. She was so mad. She was like, you should just tell me to say no then. You should just say no to me. No jumping off the swings, I guess. And then I can't have any fun. And I'm like, it's a risk versus reward thing. Like, do you find this rewarding enough? Well, then maybe it's worth the risk of hurting yourself, but it's not worth the risk of hurting yourself really badly, right? Because that's a bigger risk. So put on some gear, get back to it if you want. Risk versus reward. I'm constantly trying to ask my kids about that so that they can start evaluating this stuff on their own. Because pretty soon they're going to be teens doing their own crazy stuff out in the world. And I'm not going to be there to tell them, don't do that, stop that, that's dangerous, knock it off. When you know the odds, you're better prepared to make decisions in life. That's one way that poker helps you. It helps you start considering that everything in life has odds. Everything in life has equity, has a chance of getting to your goal. And sometimes the risk is just too great. Sometimes the reward is just too little. And sometimes you find that perfect balance and you go all in. And then it doesn't matter whether you win or lose, because you made the best decision that you could with the information you had available to you at the time. Okay, here we go on the river, do or die time. Remember, when the board has a pair on it, it's technically possible for a full house to be out there, or even four of a kind. I would be worried if I was this guy, because river raises are often death. They often mean that somebody has the nuts or the best possible hand. Given the community cards on the board. All right. This person's been at the table with me this whole time. So here we've got a flush draw if somebody had two clubs in their hand. We also have the straight draw. And now that board paired again, but people are showing not much interest. Okay, he's made a bet challenging our friend here to call, raise, or fold. Our friend chooses to raise. Our friend here is very aggressive. Let's give him a little label of accordingly. Okay, this guy's gonna bet again. And he had the full house indeed. Indeed, yes. So I'm in middle position. I do have these lovely little suited connectors, but what does it mean when the under the gun opens? It means that they, this is under the gun, that they have a lot of hands behind them they think they can beat. We decided to fold those out. Because mainly, I would want to either re-raise or fold from that position. Folding this one to the button raise. Waiting for our spot. This guy's sitting out now. Okay. What's a jack for? Why, it's for folding. And, you know, changing tires, I guess. They call a jack and a four offsuit a flat tire for that reason. Yes. If you look on Wikipedia for, like, card nicknames or poker hand nicknames, you're going to find, like, a lot of them. It's very interesting. A lot of different hands are have funny little nicknames. Well, this is a 10 and a 3, but if it was a 10 and a 2 offsuit, it would be called the Doyle Brunson, because Doyle Brunson won two different World Series of Poker bracelets holding that hand. This person raised to an interesting amount, and this person instantly called. Here's a straight draw. So this person could risk. Oh, he decided to raise. He was going to risk about 3 to win about 14, but or 13. But here he goes, raising. This guy called. Now there's a straight that's completed on the board. Ace, king, and 10. If somebody had queen jack, they would be very happy right now with their straight. This guy making the bet. He didn't believe him, or he had the actual straight. Okay, let's keep looking for math of pot odds, math of outs for straights. Hoping I get myself a good draw so that I can show really good examples of how we would calculate it on the go. So now there is a straight draw, but it's a low one. And so if you had a jack here, you would be pretty confident that you had the best hand for now. And we have a pair of fours, so we will be raising them from this position. But if somebody's going to re-raise us from the blinds, I don't know about that. We'll just probably have to call. Nope, we got it. We got it. We got it. We stole some blinds. We stole them. Ooh, and now we are under the gun. That's the first position to act. We're going to raise our fives. Now, for beginners, I wouldn't recommend raising fives from this position. If you're a beginner, you're going to want to raise just higher pairs, like sevens and up. And we got three bet or re-raised by the small blind. We're going to just flat call. This is a paired board. This is a really good board for him to bet as the preflop aggressor. He makes a bet. I'm going to fold in this case because these are some cards that poker players like to play. Hey, I got aces! Yay! It's luck. This hand, it's looking to be lucky. So we have a middle position who raised. And we're going to re-raise them. We're going to re-raise them 4 times his bet size because I'm out of position. And we would do that even if we didn't have a really great hand. Here's our opponent. He's thinking he can call, re-raise me again, or fold. He decided to call. Very kind of straighty looking board. We're going to bet. And he can, again, call, re-raise, or fold. Yay! We're taking it down. Nice to see. Okay, we are in the small blind. We don't have suited connectors, though. We have what's called a suited one-gapper. And that's not going to be good enough to re-raise from the small blind. Now here comes this flop. There's a straight draw with the king and the jack, if somebody had like a queen 10 and or something else. And there's also 2 clubs. If somebody had 2 clubs in their hand, they'd be really happy now because they would have a flush. In fact, a straight flush is possible. Very possible now. Now even a royal flush is possible. Ace, king, queen, jack, 10, all the same suit. If somebody had the 10 of clubs, it would be amazing. Oh my God, they did. Wow, they had a royal flush. You guys, did you see that? That was a royal flush, Super rare hand. You guys, royal flush, super crazy. I'm gonna have to make a clip of that. Oh my gosh. It's about 1 hour and 30 minutes into this when we saw the royal flush. Fantastic. That's only the second time I've ever seen a royal flush, and the first one during a real money game. I had a royal flush once during a play money game, so the only real benefit of that is that I got to take screen cap up on it and post it to my Facebook. But this guy had some good luck today. He needs to go buy a scratch ticket. Woo! Nice to see. It's like seeing a beautiful rainbow. If a beautiful rainbow could burn up all your money. Nice. Royal. Hey. I'm on vacation every single day because I love my occupation. Okay, let's see what we're going to do here. We may or may not play this. We will call if it's just the button. Yes, we will. And this is one of those paired boards. This one's really good for him to bet as the preflop aggressor. So he could represent either of these cards here. And I'm going to have to fold if I don't have a pair or a draw. So I'm going to fold this one. Good bet, my friend. Good continuation bet. So this is a suited two-gapper. Even worse than a suited one-gapper. Let's not play it. Let's not and say we did. Let's not. Yes. Okie dokie, my artichokies. We have a jack eight on the button. We may or may not be playing it depending on who's in. Ooh, we have a middle position open. We're going to have to fold this. If it was a jack nine though, I might consider playing it, but I would want to try to re-raise it. Here we are in the cutoff with a pair of sixes. We're going to raise again to disguise the strength of our hand and put pressure on those blinds. Okay, so now I am in position versus this player here. I have some pretty meh value. It's a very dynamic board. I'm going to have to go ahead and just bet small. Our friend here can call raise or fold. He makes the call. Now there's a straight possible. We're just going to check. Ooh, couple aces there. If he bets, though, we're going to need to fold because our pair is very, very low. Good one, broski. All right. Let's do it. We've got beginner lessons all this week for poker. If you're interested in learning how to play the game, today is about math. The math of odds and outs, the math of probabilities and such. And then tomorrow's lesson, I believe, is going to be like basically like a field guide to opponents. Like what are different opponent types are like. So I'm going to give that example tomorrow. And I'm glad you've joined me. Thank you. Thank you for joining me. It's been really lonely this pandemic, and Twitch has been like my major extrovert outlet. Okay, so there's three clubs. Now there's four clubs. That means anyone with a club in their hand has a flush or five of the same suit. And we got a king nine in the big blind. We have a tiny raise from middle position. Normally, we wouldn't call with a king nine a raise from middle position, but if no one else re-raises or something here, we've got good odds to just give a call. and then we're going to check because we are out of position to him. King, queen, blank, 10, 9. My kingdom for Jack. And then we're going to check again. If he bets again, he's not going to give us good odds. Now I'm going to check it down, try and check it down with just a king high. Because sometimes a king high will win. Sometimes an ace high will win. Anything less than that, hey, see, his ace high won. Anything less than that, you're going to have to bluff your face off. Ugh, this is just a silly, silly chest. It's silly chest. It's going to make me win a dollar to do sports betting on. And I'm like, I don't want to do sports betting, bros. Whoop-dee-doo. No, thank you. No, thank you. Sports betting does not hold any interest to me. Hey, I love me some hockey. I love me some Canucks. But I don't want to bet on them or anyone else. Except myself. Betting on myself here, okay? I'm investing in myself here. Woo-da-ba-ba-bow. Ayo. Now we have a king and a seven. It's not good enough to play from here. Why? Because we're first to act and we have a load of people behind us. Sometimes I'm going to play the king seven, but a better king can easily raise us from behind, especially since we have two very aggressive players. If we had only guys in green, passive players, I'd go ahead and raise that there, though. I would. All right, so we have another one of those tiny, tiny, tiny raises from this guy in middle position. So I'm going to call along, unless this guy is going to three bet from the small blind. We're calling along with our king and our jack. Then we're checking here. This is a really good flop for him to bet. So I'm going to have to fold a lot of my holdings unless I have a draw. But in this case, I'm going to go ahead and raise him. Because I have two backdoor draws. And now we have an ace on the turn. Going to make a continuing bet here. Ooh, he all in. Never mind. That bluff was going nowhere. Nowhere fast. No thanks. Sometimes I like to raise on those flops when I have like a couple different back doors, but that time not so much. Our guy in green had it. He had a thing. Sometimes they got it and you got to get out of there. Lose less when you don't have it and win more when you do. That's the general guidelines of poker. All right, this time I'm on the button and the cutoff has made an open. I'm going to re-raise them. 2, 4, 6-ish. And we're going to wait and see what happens. He can either call, re-raise me again, or fold. So if he re-raised me again, that would be a 4-bet, and I would fold this. Why is he waiting so long? So long. Long wait. Okay, here we go. So my queen plus the one on the board makes a pair of queens. And I'm going to bet a little smaller because it's kind of like a game of go fish at this point. It's like, do you have a club? And then if he folds, it's like, go fish. Go fish. Now we have a king nine in the cutoff position, which is just not going to be good enough. We'll see if we can see what these guys are going to play with. So this one, it can technically make a straight, but it's less likely to make a flush because it doesn't have two of the same suit. If it did, we would play it. Increases our odds just that little bit that we need. Ba 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 ba. Now we're going to raise this one. It's our suited ace. We get a call from the button. He just matched my bet so that he could hopefully see a flop. We're going to see if we get 3-bet from the blinds. We do not. we get to see this flop. So we're out of position. This is a paired dry flop. So we're going to go ahead and bet it. We're betting small though, because we're out of position. We have to act first versus this guy. He can call, raise, or fold. He chooses to fold this time. And that works. All right, we've got a queen and a nine. They're both of the same suit, so we're gonna play this even though we're from very, very early position. This guy loves to call. Let's see what we do. Again, we're out of position versus this particular guy. This, we would say, is a pretty dynamic board. We're going to be checking this one and potentially folding. Yup, let's get out of it while the getting's good. Doot, 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 doot. Now there's two dudes in the hand still. When you have more than one person that you're playing against in poker, you can sometimes think of them as like one big, stronger enemy unit, because their range of hands is literally stronger because it's just bigger because there's two of them, you know? So let's see what they're gonna do on this river. 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 would be the only draw here that made it, but that's a very unlikely hand to have in the beginning here and call along with. So if you had an ace here, you'd be fairly confident that you still had the best hand, especially if your kicker, the unpaired card in your hand, is high. Ooh, he's gonna raise though, representing that very unlikely straight, the 6 and the 7. Yeah. This guy's got to think about it with his ace. Maybe he's got an ace jack too for two pair. Oh, is he going to make the call? Let's see. Suspense. Oh, he didn't make the call. Woo. Woo. That one was a big one. Now he's got a very short chip stack left. See if he's going to continue to play a lot of hands as he likes to do. Nope, he's not playing the next one. We're in the big blind with a suited king. And yay, we get a walk, just nothing. Yay. Oh, aces! Woo! Let's do it! Let's do it! So we're going to raise these aces. We're raising about 4 times his bet size because we're out of position, and even if we didn't have an amazing hand, we would want to raise big like that. Now there's already a potential for straights, potential for two pair. I block the upper end of that straight though. I'm going to keep betting though, hoping that he's not got the two pair here or a straight. Ba-ba. It's unlikely that he has a straight, but it is quite possible that he has two pair. Doo-doo. I'm going to bet small here, hoping that a king is going to call. Nope. Doo-doo-doo. Da-da-da-da-da. Da-dum-dee-da-bow. Okay. Pretty soon I got to wind it up. We're gonna make the calls. We're gonna make the calls. We're gonna do it all. We're gonna make the calls. We gotta do it all. Hey. I got somebody coming over fairly soon, so I'll wrap up the stream soon and we will raid somebody who's going to be super jazzed about 6 viewers. Just mind blowing. Yeah, we've got some, I follow some people who are good streamers, but they're small streamers. Good but small. Oh yeah. Buddha, Buddha, da, 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 da. All right, let's take a look at what kind of streamers we can raid at the end of this. And then I'll be on tomorrow. Same bat time, same bat channel. Oh yeah, y'all. See if we've got any more people doing Dare to Stream. Poker Night in America. Sure, sure. No poker players with very few viewers right now. But we've got Warzone. A lot of my viewers watch Warzone. So why don't we go ahead and wrong screen. Why don't we go ahead and raid somebody? He's playing a little bit of Warzone. We're going to raid Trizzy Steez, who has one viewer right now. He'll be thrilled. Here's my raid call. Make sure to touch that little heart, touch that little star below my stream if you want to learn some more about beginner poker. And until next time, take it easy, my lemon squeezies.